Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sikhism, A Very Short Introduction, Second Edition, by Eleanor Nesbitt, narrated by Siiri Scott. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Chapter 1. Introduction. Sikhism is one of the newest and smallest of the world's religions. Its media image is predominantly male, and reports often suggest that it is a religion preoccupied with swords and turbans. Personal contact with Sikhs usually impresses the outsider with energetic hospitality, while the scriptures bring the reader to a poetic vision of ordered harmony and unity, and a spiritual discipline. This book's aim is to provide a rounded account of Sikhism in its many aspects. Sikhs have a strong sense of being a community with a history of struggle, and so the sequence of this very short introduction will, in the main, be chronological. Each chapter sets historical developments in a wider context, which includes the overarching question, what does being a religion, let alone a world religion, mean? Sikhism is often portrayed as a neat package, consisting of a founder, Guru Nanak, a scripture, the Guru Granth Sahib, places of worship known as gurdwaras, and the requirement to show one's allegiance physically, by not cutting one's hair, for example. In what follows, at every stage of the Sikh story, the not-so-neat processes involved in emerging as a distinct religion will be evident. These include the Sikhs' continually evolving sense of identity, often in relation to their Hindu neighbors. These processes are still underway and spark passionate debate. The word Sikhism suggests that the book's emphasis will be on a religious system, on the theological and ethical principles of Sikhs. But that would be to misrepresent the teachings and values that have arisen from and impacted upon a particular people. It would also pander to a discredited understanding of religion as an abstract, defined entity, rather than as a fluid tradition, pulsing with life and difficult to pin down. Like Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism is a Western word, coined not by Sikhs, but by outsiders from a Christian Northern European background. Like these terms, Sikhism became current during the period of British domination of India. The term Sikhism is nowadays readily used by its followers, but is not totally satisfactory. Sikhism is an extension of the word Sikh. From the outset, it should be pointed out that Westerners are accustomed to hearing this word pronounced in the same way as the English verb seek, as if it had what linguists call a long I, but in the original Punjabi, the I is short. Sikh is correctly pronounced like Sikh, S-I-C-K, though with a final consonant more reminiscent of a C-H in the Scottish word loch than C-K in luck. Sikh means simply a learner or disciple, as the Punjabi verb sikhna means to learn. Sikhs are disciples of the guru. People who identify themselves as Sikhs answer the question, who is a Sikh, in different ways. One authoritative definition by Sikh Rahit Maryada, Chapter 1, is any human being who faithfully believes in one immortal being, 10 gurus from Guru Nanak to Guru Gobind Singh, the Guru Granth Sahib, the utterances and teachings of the 10 gurus, and the baptism bequeathed by the 10th guru, and who does not owe allegiance to any other religion. Sikhs refer to their religious path as Sikhi or Gursikhi, as well as Gurmat, the guru's doctrine. They refer to the Sikh community as a whole as the Panth. Statistics. Sikhs worldwide number about 24 million. Approximately 92% live in Asia, the great majority in India. According to India's 2011 census, the 20,800,000 Sikhs constitute 1.7% of the population, a decrease of nearly 0.2% since 2001. More than 75% of India's Sikhs live in Punjab, and this is the only state in which they form a majority, less than 58%. India's other Sikhs are mainly concentrated in six northern states and union territories, including Haryana, Chandigarh, and Delhi. There are now Sikh communities in many other countries as well, the largest being in Canada, about 455,000, and the United Kingdom, 432,429, according to the 2011 census, followed by the USA, approaching 300,000. A further 72,296 live in Australia, where Sikhism is the fastest-growing religion. Sikhs tend to be locally concentrated. For example, over 200,000 of Canada's Sikhs live in British Columbia. Europe's second-largest Sikh population, approximately 70,000, is in Italy, mainly in the north. The meaning of guru. Sikh faith and teaching can only be understood in terms of the role of the guru. The Sikh is the learner, the guru is the teacher. Sikhs sometimes attribute to the word guru the meaning remover of darkness. The word guru, lowercase, traditionally used in India to refer to a respected teacher, particularly a spiritual teacher, has by extension entered current usage in English for any expert. For Sikhs, however, the guru, always with a capital letter in the Roman alphabet, refers to each of a succession of 10 spiritual guides, the founding fathers of the Sikh faith. The concept of guru embraces more than the 10 human gurus. The Gurbani, utterance of the guru, is embodied in the scriptures. Since the death of Guru Gobind Singh in 1708, these have been consulted and venerated as a living guide, known as Guru Granth Sahib. The Sikh word Vaheguru, for God, as well as God's title, Satguru, the true guru, are reminders that God, as the divine preceptor, was guru to the first human guru, Guru Nanak. A separate faith? Now an important question. Does this community of mainly Punjabi followers of the guru, human, divine, and embodied in scripture, constitute a faith in its own right? If so, what are its markers? Five views, variously voiced by scholars, preachers, and activists, by Hindus, Sikhs, and outside observers, need to be taken into account. 1. Sikhism is a Hindu sampradaya, that is, movement led by a succession of gurus. 2. Sikhism is a derived religion, drawn from the Hindu tradition. 3. Sikhism is a blend of the earlier religions of Hindu and Islam. 4. Sikhism is a distinct revelation. 5. Sikhs are a separate nation. A sixth response forms the basis of the present book. 6. Sikhism has evolved into a separate religion in terms of Sikh's self-definition, and because Sikhism has all the markers of a religion, these include a separate scripture and calendar, separate life cycle rites, places of worship, and a sense of shared history. At the same time, in common with other faiths, Sikhism cannot be fully understood in isolation from its religious, social, and historical context. This context has, for most of its history, been principally the geographical region known as Punjab, together with the religious traditions of Hinduism and Islam. Hindu and Muslim context. The word Hindu arose as a primarily geographical rather than doctrinal term. Persians and Greeks were the first to use this word for people living east of the Indus River. Etymologically, Hindu, India, and Indus are related. Unsurprisingly, then, Hindu or Indic religious tradition is inclusive, and this tradition stretches back through the millennia BCE with no agreed starting point or founder. As well as its strong connection with India, Hinduism's unity lies in Hindus' respect for ancient texts, notably the Vedas, and in the acceptance of certain key concepts, such as the cosmic law of cause and effect, karma. The Hindu community consists of devotees of countless gurus. From time to time, a new scripture is written and becomes the central teaching of a particular movement, a sampradaya, the name used in Indian languages for a succession of gurus and their followers. Many sampradayas have a particular regional base, so that, for example, it would be as unlikely to find a Punjabi follower of the Swaminarayan branch of the Hindu tradition as to find a Gujarati Sikh. The gurus of a particular sampradaya teach their followers about ultimate reality, often concentrating on a personal god and the ways in which devotees may best express their relationship with God. The Sikh gurus are clear candidates. But is Sikhism a Hindu sampradaya? The advocates of this view are, for the most part, Hindus, who point out that the gurus' names and families were all unmistakably Hindu rather than Muslim. The teaching of the Guru Granth Sahib is continuous with, as well as critical of, earlier Hindu teaching. Some central Hindu concepts, including karma and reincarnation, are taken for granted in Sikhism, and in the Gurdwara, preachers sometimes refer to stories from Hindu tradition during their homilies. Most social convention is common to Punjabi Hindus and Sikhs. Some Hindu families, mainly those living in urban areas, unproblematically include Sikhs and vice versa. Sikhs celebrate on Diwali, the Hindu festival of lights, although they increasingly call the day Bandi Chor Diwas, and many observe the annual bonding of brothers and sisters on the day of Rakhi, Raksha Bandhan. Not surprisingly, at the partition of India in 1947 into Pakistan and India, Sikhs from the west of the new border fled with Hindus to India. But the readiness of Hindus to argue in this way may simply demonstrate Hindus' inclusive attitude to religious faiths, above all those that have developed in India. Sikh writers point to the way in which, centuries earlier in India, the Buddha's teaching was absorbed into Hinduism, and they periodically rally Sikhs to withstand the danger of disappearing into Hindu society. In any discussion of the relationship of Sikhism and Hinduism as two religions, caution is necessary, especially as no firm line can be drawn between Hindu religion and Indic culture. Nor is the relationship of Sikhism to Hinduism a straightforward parallel to Christianity's relationship to Judaism as a daughter faith. The facts that the Sikh faith has not proselytized on the scale of Christianity, and that relatively few marriages have occurred outside the Punjabi community, have ensured a culturally closer linkage between Sikhs and Punjabi Hindus than that between Christians and Jews. The different dynamic in part results from the very different numerical relationship between parent and daughter in the two cases. In the first case, Hindus massively outnumber Sikhs, the adherents to their tradition's younger offspring. In the second case, the situation is reversed, with Jews being far outnumbered by Christians. In terms of sacred texts, while the Hebrew Bible is honored in the Christian tradition as its Old Testament, the most ancient Hindu sacred texts have no such place in the Sikh canon. In North India, Muslims as well as Hindus have often been inspired by charismatic teachers. Many Muslims were attracted to Sufi saints who emphasized spiritual practices. Unlike the Hindu tradition, Islam originated outside India, with the revelation of the Quran to the Prophet Muhammad in the early 7th century CE. Muslim teaching stresses that Allah, God, is one, and denounces the practice of making images of God and worshiping in front of them. In this and many other ways, Islam runs contrary to India's indigenous devotional practices. At the time of the Sikh Guru's political power, in much of North India was in the hands of Muslims, following invasions by Muslim armies under a succession of dynasties. One result of Muslim domination was that many local families had converted to Islam. The suggestion that Sikhism is a derivative in part from Islam is misleading. Certainly, Guru Nanak used Muslim as well as Hindu titles for God. Some commentators have detected Islamic influence in Guru Nanak's emphasis on monotheism, and others have suggested that the degree of honor shown to the holy book echoes the position of the Quran in Islam. However, resonances between faiths are not reliable evidence of a historical or causal relationship. With Christianity too, a faith that the Sikh gurus did not encounter, there are deep affinities, one being in the Sikh and Christian emphasis upon divine grace, in Punjabi, Kuram, Prasad, and Kirpa. To sum up Sikhism as a blend of the two senior traditions of Hinduism and Islam is analogous to writing off English as a creole of Anglo-Saxon and Norman French, rather than approaching it as a distinct language in its own right. At the same time, treating it as a distinct language, rather than as a creole, is by no means to dispute the linguistic continuities. Neither the gurus nor their Sikhs set about making a deliberate mix, any more than the speaker of what came to be called English mixed careful measures of words rooted in Latin and Germanic languages, and then calculatingly coined new words. The claims that Sikhism is a distinct revelation and that Sikhs are a separate nation are addressed in Chapter 8. Being Punjabi. Sikhs' sense of community is not just a matter of interacting with and feeling distinct from the other major religious constituencies of North India. It also has strong regional roots. The family origins of almost all Sikhs, wherever in the world they now live, are in Punjab. The exceptions include the relatively small numbers of Western converts to Sikhism, most of whom live in the United States of America, and include Sikhs with Afghan and Sindhi ancestry. Sindh is the southernmost state of Pakistan. Punjab is the region to which the families of each of the 10 gurus also belonged, although their lives were not confined to Punjab. Guru Nanak's travels are believed to have taken him northwards into the Himalayas, as far west as Baghdad and Mecca, as far east as Assam, and as far north as Sri Lanka. And both the 8th and 9th gurus' lives ended in Delhi. Moreover, Guru Gobind Singh was born in Patna, in the present Indian state of Bihar. Nevertheless, any exposition of Sikhism that omits the significance of Punjab for Sikhs is incomplete, especially as Punjab has come to be regarded as the spiritual homeland for Sikhs everywhere. To give an example from fieldwork in Coventry, England, young Sikhs, almost all of whom were far more articulate in English than in Punjabi, and most of whom had never lived in Punjab, equated being Sikh with being Punjabi. They use the two terms interchangeably when naming their religion. Most had little or no understanding that a Punjabi could be Muslim, Hindu, or Christian, Jain, or Buddhist. However little Punjabi language they could understand, let alone read or write, they knew that Punjabi was their language. Punjab, or Panjab, as it is often written, especially by scholars, is the land of five, Panj, waters, Ab. In fact, the tributaries of the Indus. These are, from west to east, the rivers of Chelam, Chenab, Ravi, Satluj, or Sutlej, S-U-T-L-E-J, and the Satluj tributary, the river Bias. A contemporary map shows the India-Pakistan border cutting through the land drained by these rivers, so that only the Bias now runs entirely on the Indian side of the border. The present Indian state of Punjab is a fraction of Punjab before 1947. This was the year when India gained independence from British rule and was divided into India and Pakistan. Then, in 1966, India's already smaller portion of Punjab was further divided. This time, according to the declared mother tongues of the population, into the majority Hindi-speaking states of Haryana and Himachal Pradesh, and the present-day Indian state of Punjab, with a majority of Punjabi speakers, and so of Sikhs. This division was the result of concentrated agitation by Sikhs. The Punjabi language, like the other tongues of North India, is described as Indo-European and is a distant cousin of most modern European languages. The word Panj itself, like the other numbers from 1 to 10, is an example. For philologists, it is cognate with the Greek pente and the German funf, while ab is a distant relative of the Latin aqua. Nor is it a coincidence that nam, a key Sikh term for the divine reality, is so like the English word name, or that panth closely resembles the English word path. Another important Sikh word is amrit, the water used in initiation ceremonies. Amrit, literally not death, is cognate via Greek and Latin with both ambrosia and immortal. Like European languages too, Punjabi bears traces of successive invasions and migrations, including the arrival of Greeks in the 4th century BCE. Words of Arabic and Persian origin testify to the centuries of penetration and domination by Muslim rulers and by armies from further west. The guru's words for God include, as already noted, Islamic as well as Hindu designations, Allah and Khuda as well as Paramatma and Ram. The word that Punjabis use for being Punjabi, that is, Punjabiness, is Panjabiyat, a blend of language and humor and tastes in dress, cuisine, lifestyle, and the arts. Despite several generations of migration from the villages of Punjab, many Sikhs still identify themselves as a rural, unsophisticated farming people, in contrast to the more urban Hindu community. Being Punjabi involves distinctive traditions in dress, cuisine, music, and dance, as well as an enthusiasm for harrowing Romeo and Juliet-like love stories. Most famous of these is the tragic tale of Heer and Ranja, as told by the 18th century poet Waris Shah. Bhangra, the rousing drumming melody and acrobatic dance of Punjabi celebrations, has moved and mutated a long way from rural festivities. Yet, despite fusing with contemporary styles and tempos in Western popular music, Bhangra is still inextricably Punjabi. Key Punjabi values quickly become apparent to the outsider. Hospitality is one, honoring the guest with plentiful food and drink. Another is izzat, which is often translated into English as honor or as family pride. Failure to show generous hospitality would be a cause for shame to the hosts and would be insulting to the guest. Above all, over the centuries, izzat has been tied up with the way in which female family members behave or are perceived to behave. Gossip about a young woman's supposed misdemeanors, especially by associating with a man from the wrong family, brings shame on her relations and can result in violence. The fact that many Punjabi families continue to observe strong preferences, sanctioned by cultural tradition, in their selection or approval of sons and daughters-in-law might suggest a rigidly structured or compartmentalized society. In terms of popular devotion, however, there is widespread fluidity. Shrines, where healings are reputed to happen, or where supplications are likely to be heeded, draw pilgrims from a social mix in terms of both caste and religious allegiance. The devotees, and in some cases the holy places themselves, are by no means exclusively Sikh, Hindu, or Muslim. It is within this dynamic context of a Punjabi culture, richly textured by its social history, that we need to set the term Sikhism and to explore its content, connotations, and limitations. This book will explore the ways in which Sikhism, in the sense of the guru's teachings, converges with Punjabi cultural norms, which are caught up in processes of unprecedentedly rapid change, and the occasions when the guru's priorities pull in a different direction. Chapter 2, Guru Nanak and His First Successors. Introduction. Figure 2 is a devotional picture showing the 10 human gurus and the volume of scripture in a unified composition. In Sikh belief, all are physical embodiments of the same guru. One Sikh analogy for guruship is a flame that lights a succession of torches. Sikh religious pictures portray two figures more frequently and more prominently than the others. They are Guru Nanak, the first human guru, and Guru Gobind Singh, the 10th. For day-to-day guidance, Sikhs turn to the Guru Granth Sahib. Accordingly, Guru Nanak will predominate in this chapter, the Guru Granth Sahib in Chapter 3, and the Guru Gobind Singh in Chapter 4. Theirs will be the strongest influence in the book as a whole, as it is in Sikhism. Historical and religious context of the early gurus. Guru Nanak's lifespan, 1469 to 1539 CE, corresponds approximately to the German reformer Martin Luther's, 1483 to 1546. In North India and Northern Europe, respectively, each proclaimed religious insights and set in train what have proved to be enduring changes to the institutional profile of religion globally. Both criticized superstition, ritual, and priestcraft, and realized the need to communicate religious teaching through the vernacular rather than through an ancient, sacred language. However, pushing comparison further risks misrepresenting both of these reformers. Any understanding of their impact necessitates some knowledge of what preceded them and of the situation into which they were born. Whereas Martin Luther's Germany was Roman Catholic, owing allegiance to the Pope in Rome, Guru Nanak's Punjab was spiritually and culturally more diverse, a mix of Muslims and Hindus, all subject to Muslim overlords. In fact, another useful chronological comparison is that between the lifetimes of the Sikh gurus, 1469 to 1708, and the reigns of the Mughal emperors of North India from Babur, who ruled North India from 1526, until Aurangzeb, who died in 1707, just 1 year before the death of Guru Gobind Singh. The Guru's lives were directly affected by the actions of their Mughal rulers. For example, Guru Nanak alludes movingly to Babur's invasion in his compositions. Babur's successor, Humayun, is said to have consulted Guru Nanak's successor, Guru Angad. The Emperor Akbar visited the third Guru, Amar Das, and is believed to have granted land on which the Harmandir Sahib, also known as Darbar Sahib, in Amritsar was later constructed. Later emperors' interactions with gurus include the deaths of two gurus, Guru Arjan, the fifth guru, and Guru Tegh Bahadur, the ninth, and the imprisonment of a third, Guru Hargobind, the sixth guru. At the same time, the gurus' organization of their followers in some respects echoed the contemporary imperial system. The spiritual and cultural diversity was not straightforwardly that of a mix of Hindus and Muslims. Hindus and Muslims were themselves diverse. The Muslim contemporaries of Guru Nanak and his successors included Sufis, many from the line inspired by the Indian master Muin al-Din Muhammad Chisti, with their emphasis on personal experience of God. Guru Nanak's Hindu contemporaries, like their descendants today, in general expressed their devotion to Shiva, to Vishnu, to Devi, or Shakti, the goddess, through acts of worship involving offerings. Worship focused, too, on natural phenomena, the moon, sun, and rivers, and on appeasing unpleasant spirits. Families observed the appropriate rites to mark different stages in life, or following a relative's death, and people went on pilgrimage, especially to the banks of the river Ganges. A high caste minority, the Brahmins, gave instruction and conducted religious rites for their clients, for example, investing high caste boys with the sacred thread. There were several outstanding individuals of whom Nanak would have been aware. One of them was the semi-mythical Goraknath, a master yogi, whose followers were the Naths. Naths performed austerities, often as hilltop recluses, and were believed to have supernatural powers. In a composition entitled Sid Ghost, Guru Nanak robustly denounced this escapism from society. There were also the Sants, notably the poet-mystics Kabir, Namdev, and Ravidas. Both Kabir's and Ravidas's parents were low caste, and both have significant numbers of followers in the 21st century. The medieval Sants need to be firmly distinguished from those 20th and 21st century Sikhs, such as the political Sant Fateh.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.